children are our future. Teach them well and let them lead the way. Show them all the beauty they possess inside.
Welcome back to part three of our Early Childhood Leadership Academy podcast series with Dr. Anita Pandey from Morgan State University in Baltimore, Maryland, and Jessica Ruiz, an Erickson alumnus from the HER Social Policy Research Center. We are sitting here having a conversation with respect to the 30 million word gap and how we can take our critique to action and generate solutions, specifically as it relates to early childhood classroom assessments. So we've talked about what assessments are used, how we determine what assessments are used, and then some limitations and implications of these assessments from a cultural and linguistic perspective. Is there any current research or body of research that supports what a culturally and linguistically responsive assessment should look and feel like?
There's a lot of research that is showing that, first of all, we have evolved from behavioristic notions of language acquisition to nativist accounts. So in other words, children are not born with clean slates. There's more and more evidence suggesting that they're not just repeating and modeling, that they are actually producing and creating. So this notion of language acquisition is not dependent on the teacher and or the adult alone. But that stemming from peers and other children, it needs to be captured in a culturally inclusive manner by empowering children, by focusing on the interactions initiated by children and their peers, which is something that these existing tests do very little of, if any. The focus is primarily and solely on the teacher. Wouldn't you agree, Jessica?
I would agree.
And so that's one way to think about the cultural inclusion. The other way is to expand our notions of what is language and literacy. Because, for example, some of these tests evaluate the presence of books, and books are not universal literacy practices for every culture. I grew up in Africa. We were exposed to stories, and in fact, in Indian culture, books are not supposed to be put on the floor, but not everybody's privileged in many cultures to have books. They are Western concepts or memories of language that Western education is associated with. And I know that many Hispanic homes that are rated environmental rating scales are usually rated low, because when there are no physical books seen, then the score is given is very low. However, there are online books, there are technology sources of literacy like WhatsApp and other forms of literacy that are overlooked. And so we need to move beyond the traditional focus on books. Also, privacy is a very Western concept. So the proxemics, the distance between cots, the distance between, and then the nature of the furnishings, a lot is also dependent on income and social status of individuals, and also location of city. We cannot fixate ourselves on those things because they are also very cultural and subcultural.
But yes, and just to follow up with the moving forward with technology, there are programs who do have a tablet and offer that tablet with some type of electronic book for the teacher and the students, but these assessments are evolving with the technology involved in the classroom. Unless the teacher is actively engaged and involved and constantly interjecting and asking questions with a read-along on a tablet, it's considered inappropriate and as a crutch, so to speak, and that teachers should still use the paper books that we grew up with, but in a lot of these classrooms, they're evolving with the time, but the assessments aren't keeping up.
Yes, and one more research is showing that reading should be multi-sensory. So even if you go to the IRA meetings, the literacy meetings at different levels, including the Ask You Reading Recovery Conference that happens every year at the Institute, you find that more and more emphasis is on online interactive reading, the whole experience, the sounds, the visuals, because you're reading text, you can read pictures. So international movies make for a great way to teach pre-reading and cultural identities. Plus, there needs to be a linkage outside of the classroom. You need to bring the home into the classroom. If you're going to look at just the classroom, you need to connect the home and the community. We need to be able to get a portfolio and a representative sample of video so footage, not just one 15-minute slot here and one raider, because there's also the observer's paradox that the presence of an outsider can change the behavior of both the children and the teacher. And that is something that that is not eliminated. That creates bias. So when you have online footage that is captured by the facilities where the children become so familiar with the camera that they're no longer aware of it and they're free, those samples in a portfolio, an electronic portfolio of the teaching would be more representative in my view.
So thinking about, you know, a culturally and linguistically inclusive early childhood classroom assessment, can you all speak to, do we have anything like that right now that's currently in practice?
I would answer that starting with this idea of culture. What is culture? Culture is religion, culture is language, culture is gender. How do we really define what culture is so that it could be inclusive of all cultures?
To me, as a linguist, I always bring everything back to language, because nonverbal language is language, written language is language, behavior is measured through the ability to respond, which is linguistically realized in some form. So when we look at language, we need to think about what are the rules of engagement, pragmatics. In many cultures, it is considered very rude for a youngster or a child not to initiate the conversation, like in Kenyan culture. It's disrespectful, so if you enter the classroom, you have to do most of the talking, you have to initiate the conversations. But in Indian culture, it's the reverse. And in many African cultures. So even when you're looking at interaction, the cultural aspects of what is acceptable and who has to take the turn first and what kinds of turns are acceptable. Mm. Interruption is also not a universal practice. Mm. I know of many cultures like the Kenyan culture, like among the Kisii tribe in particular, where you are supposed to intrude at any point, and the louder you are, the more likely you are to be heard. This is true even of India, multiple conversations happening at the same time. But in most of the tests that are available, there is this idea that there's the teacher who is initiating it, and so there's this, the interruption doesn't seem to be accommodated. So these are the other dimensions that a culturally inclusive test would have to consider.
Mm-hmm. And not to mention those children who are developmentally delayed. Teachers can talk all they want to the student, ask open-ended questions, touch that higher order thinking. But if a child isn't responding, if a child isn't able to respond with an answer and to engage and to create feedback loops, is this inclusive?
So it sounds like, you know, there needs to be sort of some really clear guidance, because I think what's also important, although we have these cultural and linguistic considerations and also the piece around developmental delays, is that we don't want to homogenize folks either. And it's really important that there be some considerations for heterogeneity within cultures, because we don't want to stereotype, and, you know, we want to be sensitive to those things. And so I'm just kind of trying to wrap my head around, what does that look like, you know, when you're going through the certification of being an observer? How can we better prepare observers to have these considerations?
I would say that we also need to make the observation multi-setting based, and also capture different time periods during the day and during the school year, so that we get a representative sample. And all parties need to be engaged. Parents should also be trained as observers. They should be providing observations in the home, because children spend the bulk of their time in the home and outside the classroom and community settings. So wherever those spaces are that they are frequenting, we need to be able to get a picture of that. So there has to be a multi-setting, multi-party involvement to make it more thorough and rigorous, in my view.
Right. Well, thank you. Totally appreciate your expertise and sharing it with us on this podcast.
Thank you. Muchas gracias. Asante sana.
Continue to tune in to our Early Childhood Leadership Academy podcast series, where we bring in the latest and greatest of the research and expertise in our field amongst Erickson faculty and our external partners. Thank you, and have a great day.
I believe that children are our future. Teach them well and let them lead the way. Show them all the beauty they possess inside.